Hello everyone, I hope like the things are not moving in the right direction, probably because of COVID-19, and I thought of creating this video lectures for Precast meanwhile as we are all under lockdown. So what is our intent? My intent is basically to cover step by step the precast production requirements for any design engineer, and these lecture series are valid for all the newbies who would like to enter into precast technology, to all the new upcoming design engineers, to people working in the factory and so on. So I'm going to cover, you know, elaboratively what are the fundamental requirements which a design engineer should fulfill and take care of for designing any precast element. So I'm going to take you across precast production requirements. So the first element that I'm going to cover is wall panels. In wall panels we have different categories like solid walls, double walls or sandwich walls. And let me start with solid walls. Basically, in this particular element I'm going to cover what are the production limitations, how the production of a solid wall is typically done, then what are its shuttering thicknesses available in the market which you can optimally utilize to reduce your production time, increase efficiencies, and what are the limitations of gantry weights, gantry crane capacity and etc. So let me start with solid walls. Now as you can see that, you know, this is a typical table on which the solid wall panel is casted. Now typically the size of these solid wall panels or these tilting tables are 12 meters by 8 meters. Okay. It can be 12 meters or 8 meters the lengthwise, and widthwise it's 3 meters or 4 meters. So we get the tilting tables in following like sizes. So let me write it for you. The sizes available for tilting tables are 12 meter by 4 meter, okay, 8 meter by 3 meter. You can have 12 meter by 3 meter as well, and so on. It's a combination of, so generally the sheets, the steel sheets which are readily available from SR or any standard companies, so there are coils of steel sheet available with a width of 4 meters, and then there are, well, they are along the lengthwise, it's available for a roll. So you know, these are standard sizes of 12 meters by 4 meters, or the sheet, if the sheet width is 3 meters, then for 8 meters also you can have a fabricated table. Alright, now this is the overall size of the table, but generally, you know, the shutters which are used to effectively cast the wall panel takes some amount of space. So practically, you know, the effective useful area on the table, I would say, you know, on the table it will be reduced to around, if it's a 12 meter by 4 meter table, it's roughly like 11.5 meters by 3.5 meters. Okay, this is round of figures which I'm telling you. So practically on the table of 12 meters by 4 meters you can cast a wall panel of 11.5 meters by 3.5 meters. That is what you should keep in mind, number one. If at all your floor to floor height is, you know, less than 4 meters, then practically your wall will be casted in this fashion. This is the flow to flow height of the wall, and then along the length, whatever, you know, wherever you are breaking the wall panel as per your design considerations, accordingly it will be casted. Now what if your wall panel flow to floor height is greater than 3 or 4? Then the wall panel will be casted in the opposite direction and the length of the wall panel will be restricted to 3.5 meters. Okay, in that case you'll have to provide the lifters in both the directions, first on the side in which you would like to do the lifting at the initial stage, and then the wall panel is rotated. So this is a very important point I would like to make. So I mean, the design engineer should take this into consideration. If your floor to floor height is equal to or lesser than 3.5 meters, then it's fair enough. You just need to provide the lifters on one face. If your floor to floor height is greater than 3.5 meters, then the wall panel will be casted along the length of the table and then it will be rotated to get the output. Number one. Okay, so this is the production limitations which you have on a table. For special cases, definitely, you know, you can cast the wall panel on the epoxy floor and you can retrieve the wall panels as well. And I mean, for a project of a huge scale and size, even you can have a bigger size of a table, but these are the standard table sizes which are available in the market as of now. Okay. Now the second point that I would like to take you across is the shuttering thicknesses. In certain factories, what happens is regularly they have a demand of certain wall thicknesses. Now if those shuttering systems or thicknesses are readily available in the factory, one should always keep in mind that the designer should accommodate those thicknesses. Okay. Now what happens is, let's say a wall panel of you know, one such shutters which are readily available in the market. Okay, so these shuttering thicknesses, this is the side shutter. If you want to achieve a shear key of this profile in nature, you know, these kind of magnetic side shutters are readily available. Okay, and I'll show you the technical specifications of such kind of shutters. So for instance, let's talk about, you know, these are the profiles of the side shutters. So one can see here that, you know, this is a side shutter thickness of 160, and on this face basically you can have wall panel with this shear key, or you can have a flat edge also. Okay, then you have a side shutter of readily available of 120 mm wall, and this is a typical length available of any side shutter, and this is a side shutter of 100 mm thickness, and so on. Okay, so primarily, you know, you should see what kind of thicknesses the factory can manufacture based on the shuttering systems available. Okay, these are high-end magnetic side shutters which attach to these tables while we do concreting and so on. Okay, so I think I have discussed about the wall panel length and width which can be produced, what are the thicknesses of wall panels which can be produced. Now theoretically these two parameters are okay, but we also have weight limitations. I mean, this entire table is designed to, let's say, produce a wall panel of 200 mm thickness maximum, beyond which the hydraulic systems which are lifting this particular table might not be designed. Okay, so practically it's not viable to produce the thicknesses of the panel beyond that particular weight. So this parameter also needs to be considered. Second, there are gantry cranes which are running above the plant. Okay, so these gantry cranes have certain limitations and that should be taken into account. For instance, in this particular image, you can see that the gantry crane is around 16 tons. Okay, so primarily your wall panel cannot exceed the weight limitations of the gantry crane within the factory environment. Okay, otherwise you will have to use external mobile cranes and so on to lift the same wall panel, but that reduces your production efficiency again. So our overall intent always would be, you know, to increase the production efficiencies, to reduce the cost and the time. So if whatsoever is available within the factory environment is effectively utilized, then the cost is drastically reduced, because let's say within 8-hour shift you can practically give more amount of output. So gantry crane limitations in the factory should be captured in the design phase itself. Then the side shutters, as I've told you that, you know, the side shutters whatsoever is readily available at the factory should be utilized. Let's say, as right now I mentioned that 100 mm, 120 mm, 160 mm, 200 mm side shutters were available in the factory. So if I design the wall panels increasing the grade of concrete within this 200 mm, so I cannot keep the wall thickness as 180, 175 randomly. Instead of 175, I can maybe keep it as 200, right? Instead of 150, I can keep it as 160, because that side shutter is readily available. So that is what I meant to say here as well, that side shutters hurdles should be captured in the design phase. Whatever side shutters are automatically available in the factory should be utilized, so that manual shuttering work is enormously reduced. Okay, in some of the factories we have automatic robots to place these side shutters. Okay, you can in fact Google about automatic side shutters placement in precast factories, and you know, you can see a lot of amount of information. Okay, so if I take you across, you know, you can see certain robots which are placing the side shutters automatically. Okay, so if you see this this particular image, okay, so these robots are lifting the side shutters from an assembly and they are placing the side shutters as per the marking in the factory. So as much as we utilize the factory in-house capability, you know, we'll overall reduce the cost and time. Structural engineers primarily look at the concrete and steel BOQs, that's it. That doesn't really help in precast. Let's say even if your concrete shoots up by, you know, 0.5%, okay, but your production efficiencies will increase enormously. That will, you know, overall bring efficiencies to your project. So by increasing the concrete strength or concrete sizes, if you can drastically reduce the steel content and bring in the efficiencies to production and erection, that would be a huge benefit in precast technology, and one should always keep that in mind. Moving to the next point, you know, what are the good shuttering oils which can be used to get, you know, good finishes? So I mean, to give you a few brands, so there are a couple of few available. So shuttering oils and mold releases oils are available globally. So normally that could be used, you know, you can just, you know, what are the formwork oil types which are used, let me show it to you, you know. So few of these mold releases oils are available, which, so this helps you, you know, in you know, getting the staining and getting proper finish of the concrete and so on, right? So proper shuttering oil should be used prior to pouring of concrete, that drastically helps you in very easy de-shuttering of your concrete elements. Okay, so this could be readily found in the neighborhoods, and this is not a worry at all. I just wanted to cover this point as well. Now, second point is, you know, generally vibrating motors are attached to the table. Okay, now there are a couple of you know, vibrating motor suppliers are available who you know, so these motors are either movable or at stagnant. It depends from factory to factory. See, these are the motors which are attached to the bottom of the tilting table for vibrations. Now these motors come into two configurations. These are removable motors. I mean, you can shift these motors from table to table, or these are, you know, fixed motors at every table location. So based on the, you know, the quantity and scale of your project and your factory setup requirements, these particular assemblies could vary. You can see these hydraulic jacks as well. These hydraulic jacks are also movable. These could be, you know, movable from you know, table to table. So every table might not have attached, you know, hydraulic jacks, and in this way you can reduce your cost. So probably we can have all tilting tables, but the tilt facility could be movable from one table to another. Likewise, it could happen. Okay, so this is what I wanted to show you. Now moving to the next part. Okay, now what is the indicative cost of these kind of tables, you know? So, you know, the cost of this tilting table roughly comes, you know, around, I'll just tell you the costing. Now, coming to the costing part. So typically this tilting table that you see, you know, it roughly goes to anywhere about, you know, 10 lakhs Indian rupees. Then, you know, what I have shown you is hydraulic tilting system, that is hydraulic jacks. That costs around like 3.5 lakhs, and you require one pump. So that is around 3 lakhs. So overall, roughly, like, it ends up to 6.5 lakhs. And one motor that you require for vibration, that's high frequency motor, is roughly around 60,000. So you require 6 each. So it's around 3.6 lakhs. Right. So along with that, if I just sum it up, the entire costing of one tilting table roughly goes about 20 lakhs INR. Okay. So with this, I hope I have, you know, taken into account all the factors which are required for internal production as well as for setting up of a tilting table. Right. So I think with this, let me end the session. And note that these are the internal factors which a designer needs to consider from the perspective the wall panel is going to be fabricated in the factory. Then there are other factors which are not discussed, wherein, you know, what is the trailer maximum height which is allowed in the transportation. Probably in India, you know, it is around 5 to 5.5 meters. If there are some dowel bars sticking out of the wall panel, so this entire height of the wall panel width, the dowel bar and things like that needs to be considered, because this wall panel will be finally, you know, stacked on the A-frame, which will be loaded on the trailer and then transported. So these are the internal factors which I have discussed, and let me sum it up. I have discussed production limitations at the table, what are the shuttering systems a factory can have that needs to be considered in the design. Weight limitations is a very important parameter which we need to figure it out in the design stage before
the wall panel finally goes into the production stage, because that is a huge challenge. If we design the panels and the entire building, and then finally there is a challenge in the production. So weight restrictions which are available from the table weight considerations perspective, what are the gantry limitations in the production unit, so that is another factor which needs to be considered. So with this, let me end the session, and we'll see you on the next topic of the wall panel, how it can be fabricated using battery molds. Thank you.